Good morning, and welcome to Worship at Wesley. I'm Pastor Dan Kincrady, and today we come to the fourth and final sermon in our series, Reflecting on Our Lives During the Pandemic. Today's theme is Restore. Also, I hope you've had opportunity to pray over your 2021 commitment card and send it back to us. We've received so many, but I know there are even more to come in. We will be blessing those commitments during the offering today. I also want to update you on the fourth annual Interfaith Alliance Thanksgiving event. With new gathering restrictions in place this past week, the event is now completely online. So check the Wesley Weekly, check the Electronic Spire newsletter for links. You can go on Facebook and share something that you're thankful for during this season of gratitude. And today at 5 p.m., there will be a Zoom gathering with prayer, readings, and candlelighting. Even if you can't join in for the Zoom event, consider lighting a safe candle, placing it in your outside window from 5 to 9 p.m. this evening, and be part of that Interfaith Thanksgiving event. Now let's enter into a time of prelude, a time for reflection, and thinking about how God restores us in our living. Would you join me now in our responsive reading that we use each week to remind each other who we are as a gathered faith community? Responsively saying, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Wesley United Methodist Church is a diverse, welcoming, and affirming community united in Christ.
We welcome and extend the grace of God to everyone.
If there's somebody there in the room with you right now, would you extend God's grace to them? let them know that God cares about their life.
Good morning. This is Deborah Jeongmi Kang, Associate Pastor. While watching this service, you may be sitting on your couch in your living room, or you may be sitting at your desk with lighting a candle, or you may go outside and walk in your garden. Wherever you are, God is with you, holding you. It's time to worship. Open your hearts to God who restores us. I invite you all to join in call to worship. In worship, we tell a story.
A story of an unfettered love that changed the world.
In worship, we tell a story.
A story of how we live and how we long to live.
In worship, we tell a story.
Because we are forgetful people.
May we remember who we are.
May we release the narratives that trap us.
May we reimagine this world to see what God sees.
And may we work toward restoration.
It's all that easy, and it's all that hard.
Let us worship Holy God.
Psalm 145, a psalm of praise, proclaims, "Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom." We invite you to join in with us in the singing of this praise and worship song of thanksgiving. For great is our Lord.
Unto the Lord, call on His name, make known among the nations what He has done, and proclaim that His name is exalted. Oh, great is our God, and He's great to be praised. Oh, great is our God, and He's great to be praised. Give thanks unto the Lord. Call on His name, make known among the nations what He has done, and proclaim that His name is exalted. Oh, great is our God, and He's great to be praised. Oh, great is our God, and He's great to be praised. Sing unto the Lord, He has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world. Shout aloud, sing for joy, O people of Zion. Oh, great is our God, and He's great to be praised. Oh, great is our God, and He's great to be praised. For He's great. For He's great. For He's great. For He's great. Awesome, powerful. For He's great. Awesome, powerful. For He's great. Awesome, powerful, mighty. For He's great. Awesome, powerful, mighty. For He's great. Awesome, powerful, mighty. Excellent. For He's great. For He's great. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, King of Kings. Oh, how great is our God, and He's great to be praised. How great is our God, and He's great to be praised. For He's great. For He's great. Awesome, powerful. For He's great. Awesome, powerful. For He's great, awesome, powerful, mighty. For He's great, awesome, powerful, mighty. For He's great, awesome, powerful, mighty, excellent. For He's great, for He's great. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, King of Kings. Oh, how great is our God, and He's great to be praised. How great is our God, and He's great to be praised. For He's great, yes, He's great, great is our Lord.
Pastor Julie, the campus minister here at Wesley. And I think there's something kind of important and special coming up this week. That's right, it's Thanksgiving this Thursday. I wonder, are you getting excited about celebrating Thanksgiving? Are you looking forward to some of your favorite foods, like maybe some turkey or some dressing? That's one of my favorites. Maybe some cranberry sauce or some mashed potatoes. I bet you have something that you're looking forward to this Thursday. But it is going to be a little different, maybe, than in years past. Not all of us are going to be able to celebrate with the people we normally see at Thanksgiving, and that may make us a little sad or a little disappointed. But that's okay. It's still Thanksgiving. There are still reasons for giving thanks. And I want you to think about what you are thankful for right now. A couple of years ago, I took a group of our students to the Cunningham Children's Home, and we led worship on a Wednesday night with their children and youth, and our theme was giving thanks. And we had these foam leaves that were yellow and orange and green and brown, and we gave them out to everyone, and we asked them to write at least three things they were thankful for on the leaves. And everybody worked really hard and thought of the different things they were thankful for, and then we took those leaves and we taped them up on a wall, and it looked like a giving thanks tree. And here's a picture of Kenny, our campus ministry intern, standing right in the middle with all of these leaves showing all the things that we were thankful for. And I thought maybe that would be a good activity for us to do this Thanksgiving. But maybe you don't want to do a leaf. You can if you want. But I was thinking, you know what would be appropriate is to do a turkey. So if you just, you know how to do that with your hand, you just draw around your fingers real quick with a pencil or a crayon or a marker, and you have the outline of a turkey. And there are five fingers, or the turkey's head, and some feathers. And I thought, how about if we draw a turkey and we each think of what are five things that we are thankful for? And you could just jot those down, and they might be a particular friend or a family member, or maybe your house, or maybe flowers. I love flowers. They're so pretty. And I'm going to put my parents. So here's what my Thanksgiving giving thanks turkey looks like. I'm thankful for my dog, Eden, and for my home that keeps me warm and safe. I'm thankful for lots and lots of friends. Oh, and the flowers, even in the fall and winter time, I still like to see them in the store. They're so pretty, and in the grocery stores. And my parents. Now, I could think of a lot more things to be thankful for, but I want to challenge each of you kiddos and big kiddos too to make a Thanksgiving giving thanks turkey with your family or just by yourself. And what are some of the things that you are thankful for? And you can really decorate your turkey, put some more feathers on, maybe put more things that you're thankful on. And I would invite you to post a picture of your picture and yourself, or just your picture, on our Wesley United Methodist Church Facebook page this Thanksgiving, this Thursday. Let's post our Thanksgiving giving thanks turkeys and look at all the different things that we still have to be thankful for, even in years when it's a little harder, even in years where we may not get to see all of the friends and family we would normally see, at least not in person. We know that we're doing this so that everyone stays safe and everyone stays well. We can give thanks for everybody feeling good and being okay. So I invite you to do your picture, post it on our Facebook page, and I look forward to seeing what you're thankful for this year. Will you pray with me? I'll say a phrase, and then I invite you to repeat the phrase as we pray together. You put your hands together and bow your heads. Dear God, we are thankful for all your good gifts. Help us to see and give thanks for the gifts you share every day. And help us to share our gifts with others around us, so we all have a reason to be thankful. Amen. I hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving celebration.
As we enter into a time of prayer, I invite you to take whatever position it is that helps you pray. So I invite you to close your eyes, take a deep breath, and center yourself in this moment with God. Holy God, thank you for your presence with us today. Thank you for your presence with us every day. Thank you not for what you can do, but for who and what you are. As we approach the holiday season, we ask for your continued grace, strength, and wisdom. The holiday season can often become a busy and stressful time, and this year we are experiencing an additional collective stress. We ask for your continued presence with your people, Lord. Give us the strength to do what we need to keep each other safe. Give us the wisdom to know why we are taking precautions. We lift up those that are dealing with financial hardships, as we know that these are exacerbated during the holiday time. We lift those that are expecting, specifically during the ongoing pandemic. We know the inherent stress of childbirth, as well as the issues that our expectant mothers are additionally facing during this time. Lord, we lift up Wesley members that are experiencing medical issues and those that are in rehabilitation. Please give these individuals rest and recuperation. While we have lifted these up to you, we also remember that the holiday season is cause for celebration. We recently celebrated Thanksgiving, a day for us to take some time and count our blessings. Thank you for each of the reasons that you give us cause to celebrate. Thank you, Lord, for all of the beauty and joy that you bring in our lives. Please bring comforting moments among the difficult days. And during this holiday season, show us signs of your goodness and love. And now we pray in the way that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, Wesley family. Would you join me in the prayer for illumination? O God, as we open the pages of the scriptures, inspire us to hear a message for our day. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from the New Testament book of John, chapter 21, verses 1 through 19. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far off from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, Follow me. Words inspired by God for the inspiration of the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Come on in where the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is going on. Come on in where the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is going on. Come on in where the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is going on.
At the table,
at the table,
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 Today we continue to reflect on living our lives and leaning into our faith during this pandemic. Today's focus is on restoring. To restore means to repair, to mend, rebuild, rehabilitate. The Hebrew word for restore is chaya. The root word is chai, which means life. Every morning, Mrs. Lana says she wakes up feeling half dead, but she goes to the kitchen, makes her tea, chai tea. After drinking her chai, all of a sudden, Mrs. Lana is refreshed, renewed, alive again. Some of us go through the same ritual with coffee or Pepsi or some other caffeinated drink. Chaya means to restore life. It can speak of the restoration of physical life, as in revive or resurrection. It can speak of restoring the joy of life. And it can speak about the restoration of hope and faith. We know that God is in the business of restoring people better than they were before. Our God is a God of restoration, who restores life, joy, and purpose to our lives. In the Bible, within our Wesley connection, all around the world, are one story after another about God restoring life and joy and purpose to people's lives. When people feel everything good in their life has been destroyed, Jesus comes along. Not only does he restore lives to the level where they had been, but he restores life to a level we never dreamed possible. Remember these stories from the Gospels. A woman who had a hemorrhage for 12 years and could not be healed by anyone came up behind Jesus and touched the fringe of his cloak, and immediately her hemorrhage stopped. As Jesus entered a city, a dead young man was being carried out, the only son of a widow. When Jesus saw her, he said, "Do not weep." And then he touched the stretcher and said, "Young man, arise." And the young man sat up and began to speak. A deaf man was brought to Jesus. Jesus took him aside and laid his hands on him. He looked up toward heaven and said, "Be opened." At once the man's ears were opened, his tongue was unrestricted, and he began to speak clearly. A woman caught in adultery sits in a heap in the dust. She's made to feel like nothing. She is about to die. Jesus says to those surrounding her, "If you are without sin, cast the first stone." Everyone goes away, and Jesus says to her, "There is no one left to condemn you." God restores life. God renews joy. When the people of Israel were captives in Egypt, the God of restoration set them free. They crossed the Red Sea into a new beginning. Later, when the people of Israel were overrun by Babylon and lost their land, their homes, their temple, they became captives. They were grieving and at a loss. And God sent a message to them through the prophet Jeremiah saying, "I will restore you to health and heal your wounds." And the prophet Amos assured them, telling them, God says, "Behold, days are coming when I will restore my people. They will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them." And the people did return, and God helped them rebuild their homes and restore the temple. God is a God of rebuilding. When relationships are on the brink, God can reunite and restore forgiveness and trust. There was a time, just after the resurrection of Jesus in the Gospel of John we heard earlier, when the disciples didn't know what to do. They were grieving and confused. Their entire lives had been turned upside down. They weren't sure what to do next. We've all felt like that. So what did they do? Those who had been fishermen went back home to the Lake of Galilee and went fishing. Peter was among them, feeling horrible about breaking his promise to stand with Jesus in his time of need. Peter tried to remain strong, but ended up denying his connection with Jesus not once, but three times. The fishermen had gone out in their boat and fished all night, and they hadn't caught a single fish. Everything was going wrong. They couldn't even fish anymore. But while they were out fishing, the risen Christ had made a charcoal fire on the beach and fixed breakfast. When they came close enough to the beach, he called to them and asked, "Did you catch any fish?" "No, none," they answered. "Put your net on the other side of the boat," he said. And when they did, they caught so many fish, they could barely haul it in. Jesus had come to restore their faith and their hope. During breakfast on the beach, Jesus asked Peter three times, "Do you love me?" And each time Peter answered, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." In asking the question three times, it allowed Peter to affirm Jesus three times. It rebuilt the connection, the relationship they had. It mended and restored Peter's heart. Jesus doesn't want any of us to live with guilt or shame. He wants us to know we're forgiven, restored, filled with his grace and peace. Jesus wants and waits to restore us. When we fail to live and act in faithful ways, when we let our family or friends down, his love is always there to bring renewal and restoration. Brian Bononi is an architect. One of the things he does is to help clients move into new office spaces. It's a pretty routine assignment. He goes into all kinds of spaces, shuttered restaurants, creaky old houses, and shiny new office buildings. Last year, a client was moving into a storefront at an outdoor mall. The space had formerly been occupied by a photography studio. Tenants vacating rentals don't always do the best job cleaning up, and usually a cleaning crew is needed. Brian walked into the abandoned photography studio. All the photo processing equipment was still there. Against one wall was a huge stack of portraits wrapped in plastic. He picked one up. It was a beautifully framed family portrait printed on high-quality canvas. Some of the other photos had strips of tape with names, and some had phone numbers. Others had nothing. He looked around for paperwork, but there wasn't any. There were dozens and dozens of photos, moments captured in time, moments in someone's life, just sitting there. Brian was eager to get home to his wife and four kids. He had just come to measure the space. A cleaning crew would toss out everything the next morning. But as he pictured all those smiling faces crammed into a dumpster, he had to pull out his phone and call his wife, Dawn. What he was about to do would change his family's life and the lives of the people in the photos. Later, he and his family came and filled two minivans with the abandoned photos. After they got the photos home, Brian researched the photography company. It had closed abruptly after a bankruptcy proceeding. The CEO had vanished. There were news stories about customers not receiving their portraits and calling numbers that were no longer in service. Brian recalled how 9 years ago he had lost his job, scrambled to do odd jobs, and collected unemployment to take care of his family. He had gone to a food pantry and felt ashamed. Being laid off had wounded his pride and made him feel inadequate. Brian said, "I ignored God after my layoff, but you know, the food pantry was a provision from God. Going there gave me a nudge from God that made me want to help someone who helped make hopeful moments happen for others." That's why when he came across the photos, he couldn't just ignore them. His family got involved organizing the pictures and making calls and trying to connect with the owners of the photos. He tried connecting to people using social media. But after already feeling cheated by the photography company, people assumed his messages were some kind of a scam. Eventually, a local TV station aired a story. ABC World News Tonight did a follow-up segment. And then the flood of emails, letters, and calls started coming in. The Bononi family scheduled an open house. His two youngest were the welcoming crew. And the two older children were couriers running down to the basement to retrieve photos. People shared their stories. One woman said her photos contained the first portrait of her family with a newly adopted child. "We were devastated," she said, "when the store closed. We'd given up hope." Another woman named Larice Martin broke down in tears when she saw the portrait of her big extended family. Nearly two dozen relatives had gathered for the picture, a tribute to Larice's daughter who was about to start chemotherapy. Larice said, "Do you know how hard it was to get us all together and how much it meant to my daughter to see everyone all dressed up? You have blessed my family today." People from all over the nation wrote to Brian. One said, "I'm struggling right now, but hearing about this confirmed what I know from the Bible. God is good." God restores us so we can restore others. In the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of political polarization, God is working to restore health, hope, and justice. For those who have lost their jobs and income, God has not forgotten you. When we are at our weakest, God is stronger than any circumstances we face. God will bring the people and resources you need. For those in hospitals fighting for their lives, God is there. God is working through caregivers to renew life. For those grieving the loss of loved ones to this deadly virus, God is offering the truth that there is a new heaven and a new earth where God wipes away every tear from their eyes. There is no more death or mourning or crying or pain. And God says, "I am making everything new." As we approach the Advent Christmas season, we remember that God restores hope in times of darkness. As it says in the Gospel of John, the light of Christ came into the world and the darkness could not overcome it. Also in John, Jesus comes and says, that we might have life. He brings good news of great joy. He restores our lives. We are loved. We are forgiven. We are valuable. We are a light to the world. Would you pray with me? Restoring God, we believe you restore our bodies through the gift of Sabbath rest. We believe you restore our souls through the gift of grace and second chances. We believe you restore a hurting world through acts of kindness, feeding the hungry, welcoming the stranger, and loving all. We believe you restore our joy through Jesus, who never leaves us, forsakes us, or abandons us. Bless and guide us as we join you in bringing restoration to your creation. Amen. I hope each week you take time to consider what ways you keep your commitments to God through Wesley Church, whether that's a commitment of prayer time, a commitment of some act of service to help somebody else, a financial gift, or maybe it's the way that you commit to be there in a spiritual formation group, a Bible study, a book club, some way that you keep your commitment. Now, when it comes to financial commitments, I hope that you'll either send a check in the mail or connect through the QR code on your screen or find some other way through PayPal or the website to make sure that your financial gift gets here. But if you want to share with me by email or letter some other way that you're keeping a commitment with God through Wesley, I'd love to hear from you. I enjoyed all the emails, the letters, the cards, and even the text that have come to me sharing during the last 8 months of this pandemic, ways that people are not only finding meaning during this time, but sharing it with others. We are a restoration people because our God is a restoration God. Let's take our morning offering time now.
Blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Spirit, Holy Spirit, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
You know, I feel so blessed to serve this church called Wesley. I celebrate our ministry together with and for students, our concern and acts of solidarity with those who face hunger insecurity, our appreciation for older adults and their accumulated wisdom, and our emphasis on the importance of single people, families, and children. We are an accepting faith community that welcomes people from all cultures and races, all sexual orientations and gender identities, all financial abilities. Everyone is welcome here. We are so fortunate to be able to worship and study and serve together. Let us bless now these commitments for this coming year of 2021 as we covenant together to be a faith community that seeks God's peace and God's justice for all. Would you pray with me? Holy God, it is not always easy to give what we have. We count pennies. We weigh the pros and cons. We calculate what we have given before. And we remind ourselves what we're giving now. And yet, even though it can take work for us to practice release, we trust that you can take these gifts, however freely or reluctantly given, and use them to build a more beautiful world, a world restored to your image. For that is who you are. You are forever building castles out of sand, disciples out of people, and new life out of cautious gifts. Gracious God, right what is wrong. Balance the systems of injustice. Use these gifts to build the world that we can only imagine, but you can bring forth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Faith. just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
So glad you joined us for worship today, and hope that you'll join us again next week as we begin the season of Advent with a new sermon series, Those Who Dream. We look forward to journeying through Advent and worshiping together as God's people who dream. If you'd like an Advent devotional with additional readings, scripture verses, prayers, and questions for reflection to use during this season, we invite you to stop by the church at 1203 West Green Street in Urbana and select either the devotional that accompanies our sermon series or the traditional devotional with a brief meditation and prayer for each day. These can be found in the white holding boxes near the parking lot doors, or you may also request that one of these be mailed to you if that would work better for you. Just send your devotional request and your address to Donna Giffen at the email on your screen or call her at 217-377-8042. And just a quick reminder about the Interfaith Alliance Thanksgiving celebration today, November 22nd, with a Zoom gathering at 5 p.m. for shared prayers, readings, and candle lighting. They invite each of us to check out their Facebook page and post what we are thankful for this year before the Zoom gathering, and then to place a battery-operated candle in the window from 5 to 9 p.m. as a show of solidarity, peace, and hope. You can find additional information on their Facebook page, Interfaith Alliance CU. And I do hope that you will post this Thanksgiving Day your Thanksgiving Giving Thanks Turkey. Get as creative as you would like and share with the rest of us what you are thankful for this year.
Now I invite us to receive this benediction. Let us go from this time, remembering the love that changed the world, remembering we are called to remember who we are, to release the things that hold us down or hold us back, to reimagine the world as God sees it, and to restore our lives and creation wherever there is hurt, brokenness, or a lack of abundant life. Let us go with God as we work for love, justice, and peace. Amen. I invite us each to share the peace of Christ with one another, with those who are near and those who are distant, today, tomorrow, and throughout this week, with our words, our actions, and our love. The peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Go in peace.